All right. Thank you so much for this discussion, for inviting me to talk about the peasant movement and also about the more pressing issues that are happening right now. My name is Ramona Duminicioiu. I am a peasant from Romania in Eastern Europe. And I am a member of the coordination committee of the European Via Campesina, which is the movement of peasantry and the people who work in the rural areas. In Europe, we are present in almost 30 countries, and we are trying to change public policies in favor of the small family farms and to change our lives for the better. We feel, of course, that we play, although we play an essential role in the society, providing food, maintaining natural resources in a sustainable way. Despite our enormous role and work, we feel that we are increasingly marginalized, discriminated against, and we feel also that public policies don't speak for us and don't show enough support for us. And this is actually very risky for the future of food and agriculture and for our safety in the future.
Okay, thank you, Ramona. And Livia Campesina, how long have you been a member of Livia Campesina?
Well, my organization, my national organization that I come from, Eco Ruralis, is a member of Via Campesina since 2011. And I am a member of the coordination committee at European level since 4 years. I actually just completed my second mandate this year, but because of the extraordinary circumstances we're living, the coordination committee was not renewed. So I'm basically continuing de facto a prolonged second mandate.
Perfect. Thanks for that. Because we're Tall of Bio, and today people will know more about us. And so we're a year now in members of Livia Campesina and building our membership and all that, so we can be more part of it. I was there last year in Brussels at the General Assembly, and it was just amazing to meet people like yourself and other groups around the world. And so I just, in Ireland, peasant farmers, people wouldn't consider, they would say, oh, we're not peasants farmers, we're big farmers, you know. But it's the word peasant, it just comes from someone who produces food, really, isn't it?
Well, yes, the concept of peasant is appropriated in various ways by the smallholders around the world. For example, in the more developed countries in Western Europe, the farmers identify themselves with the values of the peasant concept, but define themselves using other words like a small family farmer, organic farmer. In any case, the values of peasant means that is somebody that is connected from the land, that is working the land to produce food. The scale, it's also very important. You cannot really have an industrial scale to identify yourself with the peasant values. So the scale has to be appropriate, integrated in the community you're coming from. There's not a standard that can be applied homogeneously throughout the world. What small scale means in Romania might certainly be different from small scale in the United Kingdom or Ireland or Wales or the different regions and territories around the world. So it has to be just a scale that is integrated in the community that you're part of and that is not dominating the community or pushing away other farmers or other people who work in the and who are present in the rural areas.
Yeah, because I mean, we have, I would consider a lot of small holdings here in Ireland, which is changing, you know, it's changing. There's a lot of this generation, my father's generation, there's very little succession in farms because it's, you know, the mantra is you can't make money in farming, even at 100 acres. So, you know, that's why I really love the peasant movement, because it's promoting and supporting small holdings so people can stay on the land, and maybe it's more community based. But so just about the values of the peasant movement, like what would you say are the values?
Well, we have very, very strong social values. It's about the people, first of all, because farming has to be for the people. They cannot, farming is not for profit or not for machines or for other things that dissociate from the people. So people have to be at the center, and the most vulnerable and the most marginalized groups have to be at the center, like, for example, the women and the youth. For La Via Campesina, these have been, they are the women and the youth are the you know, the front line always. We need the voices of the women, whose contribution is absolutely significant and has been taken for granted for too long. And we need the voices of the young people, because farming has to be also something that continues in the future and that integrates human rights and that integrates you know, the important social values. We need people. The more people we have engaged in agriculture, the better the farming is going to be, because that means you know, that the farming will be adapted culturally from region to region, will produce food that is nutritious, that is diverse, that is made really for the humans and not for other for abstract things, you know, for what is actually happening right now. You know, we are challenging the current farming and the direction that the farming is going, you know, where trade is actually shaping our food systems, and it's making the food to generate malnutrition of all kinds of forms, including you know, obesity and micronutrient deficiencies and many other problems. This process of challenging the status quo is extremely difficult, and we believe that we need to shift back towards humanity and towards the social values, towards the people.
Indeed, yeah, that's the challenges. That's why I was amazed at in Brussels, is the same challenges in Romania and Cyprus and Spain are the same in Ireland. It's just this kind of conglomerate sort of globalization of export market, and the subsidies go to the export import market as opposed to small holdings. Because so that's what Talib Yor are, we'd like to change policies in Ireland in to positively support people that grow food and benefit their own community. So that's because the new CAP, like, I mean, there's all talk about the new Common Agricultural Policy, and like, what do you think needs to happen there to help the small holdings, peasant farmers around the world or Europe? You know, let's talk about Europe for a minute. Yeah.
Well, the Common Agricultural Policy has a lot of problems, and it provides financial resources to a very small number of farmers who are already very rich. And it marginalizes the majority of the people engaged in farming, the small-scale food producers. And unfortunately, the Common Agriculture Policy is used as a reference by many other regions around the world, Eastern Europe, and really the Global South in general. And it's a standard that puts on the first priority, that prioritizes the international trade, that prioritizes profit, that pushes for overproduction and waste, food waste, and really only speaks, just pays lip service, saying that it supports family farmers as well. But in reality, practically, it does very little to nothing for the smallholders. La Via Campesina in Europe has made extensive work on CAP, engaging all the members organizations in the process for a very long time. We have our own proposals that we submitted to the Commission, European Commission, in the process, asking for a more just food system in Europe, and a better distribution of funding, so that you know, we don't continue to enrich the rich and impoverish the poor, and deepen the inequalities in the society through this policy. And we want in general a better participation in the sharing of the benefits from all the actors involved. And we need, we need these things to happen urgently. It's quite late. And we feel that, unfortunately, this current crisis did not shake enough the status quo to make the decision makers listen to us. So that is quite unfortunate.
Yeah, because it is a very good opportunity with this COVID-19 to see, because of, I mean, the things that I saw during the pandemic or during, still ongoing, but during the lockdown, was people really valued the local food grower. You know, because they only had to go, they could only go a certain distance, and like the supermarkets were there and they're always going to be there, but there was definitely more of a demand for locally produced food. So that was like, you know, the demand is there, people really want it. So policymakers, again, they're just not supported, you know, and in Ireland we've got very, you know, like there's beef barons who basically run the place, and even in terms of closing down meat factories that have had COVID-19, the workers, and we can talk about workers in a minute, because there was outbreaks in meat factories, and rather than, you know, test people and maybe close the factory for a while, it was locked down a whole county instead. You know, so you can, it's very clear there's a real influence in government for these big farming bodies, you know. So so that was with the migrant workers. We have a lot of migrant workers in Ireland, obviously. From the first thing was at the start of the pandemic was the Keeling's fruit, where they flew a lot of workers from Romania and Bulgaria into Ireland and Hungary to work picking fruit. And there was a bit of a, obviously, people were saying, well, why are you flying people in during a pandemic? And then, you know, the conditions that they were staying in was, it's kind of very basic, and they weren't really protected. And it was very obvious that this was just something that happens every year. And I suppose it's never, people weren't aware of it before, you know. So what is, you've got a lot of thoughts on the migrant rights workers, because, you know, they seasonal workers, they come to Ireland, they come back, go back to Romania, but they could have brought back the COVID now with them and stuff like that, you know?
Yeah, just before we dive into the the migrant workers, to finish the discussion on CAP, because this is really something relevant that farmers really want to know, you know, what is our plan, what is our strategies, what are our strategic points that we want to make in the CAP. So the first most important thing is that we would like to increase the number of farmers in the European countries and the territory in order to improve the quality of the food. Only a bigger number and more diverse contribution to the food system can ensure the quality. Just a few companies dictating the food security and the food production, it's only going to decrease the food quality, that is for sure. And we are witnessing that. And then we would like to provide more opportunities through CAP to engage farmers with more environmentally friendly production. Because this is the most sustainable thing. We need to address that. We need to address and face the fact that agriculture is one of the main negative contributor to the climate crisis. So the environmentally friendly models need to be supported and prioritized, actually. When we give money, we need to put the money into the future and into today. And then we certainly need decent incomes. There are a lot of farmers that are into debt around Europe and that cannot make enough living from this work and the lifestyle, which is extremely demanding. So their work needs to be dignified, and they need to be provided decent incomes based primarily on fair prices. So farmers should not be left at the hands of the retailers and the big players in the food systems who buy for almost nothing our work, our products. And the governments need to protect us and to guarantee decent incomes and strongly regulate that. And then, yes, of course, we need to pay attention to what is happening with the trade. Because the trade is influencing dramatically the food system, and we need to you know, suspend the debates and the negotiations on current free trades and re-discuss the already signed free trade agreements between the European Union and other regions, so that farmers don't have to suffer, and really evaluate what kind of negative impact, and seriously and honestly evaluate the negative impact that these trade deals will have on the people. Mm. And then we need to promote and strongly support the local and regional markets, because as we've seen and you mentioned, the crisis, the current crisis showed us that people turned towards more local food producers and to more local markets. And in times of crisis, it's the local economy who is offering the strongest support to the society. It's not the international trade who needs, and the international market, who needs a lot of resources to be maintained afloat, while local markets and the local economy needs quite little resources. It's much more dynamic. It adapts much quicker to the crisis situations. And it actually distributes the money more fairly, while the international trade market only enriches a few. So this is also a very strong priority point for us. And then we need, you know, we have a lot of points that refer to human rights that refer especially to the migrant workers, where we talk about, and we need policies that include social conditionality of aid. So farmers who exploit labor, especially migrant labor, who is particularly vulnerable, should not benefit from the public support. And we need them to be forced to recognize and pay for the social rights of the rural wage workers, to offer them decent incomes and to have non-discriminatory practices with the migrant seasonal workers and their families. So yeah, basically no support should be given to industrial agriculture, who is generally exploiting the workers, and especially the migrant labor, the migrant workers, and more support should be given to the employers, the small-scale employers, who have time and time again proven that they are the best employers. And there's a lot of work to be done. We feel that this crisis actually has not been beneficially to our voice. It actually shrinked the space of dialogue for us, unfortunately, because peasants in general and the small scale farmers were not equipped to transform immediately their work into an online process. And we don't have any more, access to different decision makers because of the crisis. Their priorities change. A lot of things change. So we feel that we are a bit left behind. That is for sure.
Well, that's a shame. Yeah, because I think. Yeah, because I value Bavia Campesina's work so much. You know, I've read a lot of policies make absolute sense, you know, in terms of, but that is really the battle, in a sense, is the global versus local, it seems. And like I discussed with Maria McGuinness, who's an MEP, who's now the new commissioner for trade commissioner in Europe for Ireland. But, she would be very much for the big agri business, you know. She kind of said that globalization, you know, export, she's kind of schooling me on how we are to make money in the export, because we export probably enough milk for 40 million people out of Ireland, you know, a small country. There's a lot of dairy, you know. So in terms of local markets, when I asked her about that, she kind of said, well, we can't have Ireland grown food for the Irish and the Austrians grown food for the Austrians. You know, she kind of made me feel like, you know, that's a silly thing to do. It's like, well, that's what you're faced against. It's big business who have made grown food locally seem, too much like her, leave it to the big boys, you know, leave it to the industry, we can take care, we can feed the world this way, when it's actually the opposite, you know. Because there's very few growers in Ireland. I was talking to my friend who is a green grower, grows veg for the local businesses, local restaurants, and well, that's now they've gone back to growing, doing veggie boxes because the restaurants were closed for a good while. But I think there's only about 300 growers in Galway County, you know, which is quite low, you know. So in terms of you're saying, how would you say you could inspire people to come back to farming, to grow food? I know, you know, the subsidies aren't there, but even to, you know, I mean, to start, where, how would one start, where you're getting grants or something like that, or just, I guess, they just have to start on their own is the way.
Yeah, and also, I mean, people need to connect to each other. You need to look around and see and find your group of people who have the same beliefs and work together, because we cannot succeed if we just engage by ourselves. We're going to lose motivation because the problems we're facing are at times overwhelming. So we need a support system, and we need to find those people that can provide us that that support. And then unfortunately, it's not enough for us to engage in food production. We have to also engage it in political processes, because things are decided by the politicians, and the public policies affect our lives. And unfortunately, when decision makers like the one you just mentioned respond, you know, taking our points, when we make a point on local markets, and they take the point so to a such an extreme, saying that immediately what you want to do is to go back to the situation from before the world wars, where everybody was just producing for itself, and that generated conflict and so on. No, it's not that we want. We are not we're not completely against the global market. We just want the local markets to not die, because it would really, like, we would cut the branch out of beneath our feet. So we need these strong pillars, which is the local markets, the local communities. We need them to be supported as well. There is space. There has to be space for us as well. It's not everything about the globalized. We're not all living in a cloud. And, you know, all of these people who are engaged in agriculture. And in Europe, we have dozens of millions, actually. Europe is not only the European Union space. It goes beyond that. And Europe is a very diverse space, which still has a lot of people in the rural areas. And they cannot simply disappear. We need to continue to thrive. And we actually are not... we are a strong pillar in the society, and we have an important role that just needs to be recognized and, you know, empowered, because we would, what we do, producing food, it's a benefit for the entire society, it's not just for us. So, you know, our politicians who seem to be lost for quite a long time, they need to get back some sense, you know, otherwise... it's all going down the drains.
Absolutely. Do you want to say, I'm just going to stop it there now, because I'm going 30 minutes are going to be up there now, but we can do another, I can just ring you again. Is that okay?
Okay.
Because I'll edit this anyway. I'll edit it. I don't know. It probably is going to show up in a second. That's got, I yeah. One sec, so. Thanks.